And I'm very skeptical towards what I call the political correctness doctrine. George Shirk points out that the diversity argument is generally advanced by politicians, but it is seldom formulated with much precision. And instead, political correctness tells us to value diversity, to respect and to support it without saying why. Well, as a woman's representative and an equality officer, it was my job to support it. But as a philosopher, I do question my own arguments and my aims. Actually, questioning is what we do. And I think philosophers can be like little children here. We can go on asking why forever. So I decided to combine both my political opinion and my philosophical skepticism to improve my arguments for the support of cultural diversity, which includes ethnical, religious, but also gender diversity. And I did so by using phenomenology and focusing the very special relation between my bodily being, and body is here meant in the sense of a German life or Japanese shintai, and that of any other person. And concerning our perception, this is characterized by both a shortage and a surplus at the same time. And the interesting thing is that my shortage corresponds to your surplus, and your shortage corresponds to my surplus. Because since we physically can never take the same place at the same time, there's always something you see and I don't. There's always something that is invisible to me, but visible to you. It's the world at my back, for example. And here trust comes into the play, because I cannot see the world at my back right now, so I have to trust all of you that there's nothing to worry about. Diversity and trust have in common that they both emerge between us. That's what makes it really interesting for me. And both are related to the benefits of interpersonal relations, but also to interpersonal conflicts. You can promise to trust another person, like you can promise to go on loving somebody, like the promise you give each other in a marriage ceremony. But I wonder, is that really your decision? Trust does not seem to be a volitional decision, but a complex attitude towards another person, a group, or even a political system. It involves sympathy or identification with the other's aims. And we tend to mistrust people we simply do not like. But at the same time, there are cases like one of my physicians. He is not really good at interpersonal communication. He's very rude. But he's a great physician. So I may not like him as a person, but I do trust him as a physician. And I wondered, what are the necessary conditions for trust then? Bernard Helm argues that trust as a reactive attitude towards another person is one of the responses to one's knowledge or belief about what has already happened. It's responses in which one praises or blames somebody for their part in what happened. And in the past, my physician's treatment helped me. So I trust that it will do that in the future too. I can praise him for being a good physician, while at the same time I can blame him for not being a very nice person. Carolyn McLean points out that the attitude of trust is nothing one can will oneself to have without any evidence of a person's trustworthiness. But nevertheless, there seems to be some difference between trust and knowledge. There seems to be a difference between my trust in my partner that he does not cheat on me and my knowledge that he does not cheat, based on continuous surveillance, for example, or between my mistrust in him and my knowledge that he did cheat, because proved by evidence, because he was caught in the act, for example. So trust seems to me at least a tiny possibility of disappointment, doesn't it? A very solid kind of trust may be a child's self-evident trust towards the parents. I likewise may trust my papa self-evidently. The missing evidence for mistrust and the evidence in the child for the child's trust, that is, the parents give food and shelter in most of the cases when the child requires it, both fulfill the condition of reliability formulated by John Turley. And he said, you're reliable if you do and would succeed most of the time. Such a self-evident kind of trust in a reliable person only becomes aware when it is questioned. In the child's case, this may be the general disappointment of realizing that the parents are just humans. They do not have an answer to every possible question, and they even lie to us. There's no Santa Claus, and babies are not delivered by a store. The trust in a partner may become aware without being shaken. For example, when a friend tells me that her partner cheated on her, and I become aware that I do trust my partner, and I am not in the least concerned that he would cheat on me. But there's another kind of trust where the disappointment comes first. Think of all the Hollywood movies where at some place the heroine meets the hero. They got to know each other, then she got disappointed in him. Maybe he was just rude or selfish or indifferent. But finally, there's a kind of danger where he might help her, or maybe only both together can save the world. And he says, you must trust me now. And we, as the audience, think, yeah, trust him. He did something wrong, but he's a good one. And you have to save the world. And of course she does, and we do save the world. So the proof of trust is linked to a possible disappointment, I would say. A possible danger. The world at my back. Or just think of the popular trust game used in schools or companies to improve the team spirit. For example, a schoolboy stands before a classmate with his back turned to her, and then he has to let himself fall into her arms, trusting that she will catch him. The point is that the whole procedure would be pointless if the boy would have trusted her completely before this little experiment. And usually, the school children squeak half with pleasure and half frightened, and they are relieved and happy if they are caught. Maybe trust is most aware after it was questioned, uncertain or in danger, and then reassured. If so, we indeed cannot have trust in the person without evidence of the person's trustworthiness. In the cases named above, this is the fact that the girl called the boy, and that the hero indeed saved the heroine or the whole world. Why? Usually, we as academics do not save the world. But the trust in other people, in academic and non-academic cooperation, leads to improvement. And here, diversity in the sense of diverse individual perspectives and trust meet. Because all people involved have to trust each other that they work towards the same end, and that the contributions are honest. James Bowman called this the common first-person plural perspective, which occurs, for example, when patients occupy positions on review boards for the sake of improving experimental practices beyond the single-point perspective of experts, and makes such evaluations multi-perspectival and thereby more robust. The more people look at the same object or issue from different perspectives, the better is the description or the solution approach they can offer together. And I think this basically epistemological approach is applicable to moral questions concerning affirmative action, which we will hear about in our first lecture today. Besides that, we will discuss the relation between diversity and trust within politics, which is especially interesting for me due to the worldwide current political situation. Think of Brexit or Trump or the recent elections in Germany and those here in Japan which take place today. We will also discuss the so-called cultural harms and benefits of diversity as they are defended in liberal tradition, or the question which positive concept of trust religions have to offer. We will explore the limits of trust which are set by diversity, and the relation between implicit biases and stereotypes and gendered artifacts. So we will close with gender issues from a philosophical perspective, and we will start with gender issues from a perspective of law. And I hope that our diverse perspectives on the issues of diversity and trust will enhance each other during this workshop. So please welcome our keynote speaker, Professor Carol. Thank you.